Hebrews chapter 12. So if you want to open that up, Hebrews chapter 12, starting at the start, going through to verse 11. And let me read the word of the Lord. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. And have you completely forgotten this word of encouragement that addresses you as a father addresses his son? It says, "My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you, because the Lord disciplines the one he loves, and he chastens everyone he accepts as his son. Endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as his children. For what children are not disciplined by their father? If you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline, then you are not legitimate, not true sons and daughters at all. Moreover, we have all had human fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them for it. How much more should we submit to the Father of spirits and live? They disciplined us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplines us for our good, in order that we may share in his holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it."
Thanks, Keith.
Well, good morning, church. It's good to see you this morning. My name is Mitch. It's great to meet you if I haven't met you before. I'd love to meet you after the service as well. I'm one of the staff here at Anchor. I'm also part of West Pimble Gospel Community. It's a privilege to be opening the Word with you this morning. I really love this passage, Hebrews 12. This is actually the first passage that I ever preached on when I was probably about 10 years ago when I was 18 or 19 at my previous church. I actually went looking for the recording of that sermon during the week and I couldn't find it. And I was actually glad that I couldn't find it because I'm not someone who enjoys listening back to myself and especially not my 18-year-old self. I'm not sure if that's the same for you. But I love this passage. I'm looking forward to getting to it. And it's talking about endurance, talking about perseverance in the faith. How do you endure for the long haul as a Christian? This week, we as a GC, we were going to have our end of term dinner party at the Stewart's place, Tom and Chloe Stewart, who are part of our community. They have the biggest space of everyone in our GC. So we're going to have a barbecue and celebrate what the Lord's been doing this term. But I got a call from Chloe on Monday morning and she said, "Mitch, we're not going to be able to host GC again because the boys have gastro. They've got two little sons, Archie and Wilfred, and they're sick." And the thing with the Stewart's is they've been sick all year. They haven't had a month over the past year where they haven't had some sort of illness. They've had colds, flus, fevers, gastro several times, even a spider bite that led to the hospital. They've just had a very bad run for the last year. We've been journeying with them as a GC this whole year throughout this sickness, praying for them, asking the Lord, you know, what's going on? And Chloe just shared as we were chatting on the phone, she just shared her exhaustion and her just exasperation at the past year. Just how sick of being sick they are. The questions that she's asked the Lord, why are you doing this? Why do we have another month where we aren't well, another month of sickness for 12 months? They're just exhausted. They're finding it hard to persevere and endure. Just honest, valid questions that they've been asking the Lord. And I wonder if you found yourself in a similar situation in the past where you've just been asking, God, what are you doing? Why are you still doing this? Why am I suffering? What is happening? I know I've had this experience before. Probably the most significant time for me was about 4 years ago. I was living in Adelaide. Sarah and I were living in Adelaide, and I'd just been fired from what was my dream job at the time. We'd moved to Adelaide for this job. We didn't know anyone in the city. It was a huge move for us. We prayed about it. We'd been careful. We moved, and then I was in the job for about 10 months before I got fired. It was also the most difficult period of our marriage that we've ever experienced, and there were times for us where we were wondering, are we even going to make it? Is our marriage going to survive? And I was angry and I was asking the Lord, I was, God, why are you doing this? Why are we suffering in this way? Why would you bring us here if you knew this was going to happen? So many questions, so much anger and confusion. how to endure, how to persevere when you're suffering and experiencing difficult things. And that's the question that this passage in Hebrews is trying to answer. What do you do when you're so exhausted and you don't know if you can keep going? What do you do when you're suffering and you don't know why and you're not sure what the Lord is doing? Questions that need to be answered, because if these questions are answered poorly, then they're going to lead to a faith that is not going to be sustained, a faith that isn't going to make it for the long haul. If you want to persevere in your faith, you need to be able to answer those questions. Because suffering will come in your walk. It may have already. I'm sure it has. I know it has for a lot of us in this room. But it will come in the future if it hasn't. So that's what Hebrews is trying to answer. And it's, I think there's two answers in this passage to that question. How do we persevere? How do we run with perseverance? First, by keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus. And second, by enduring hardship as a discipline. Those are two things we're going to speak about. Fixing our eyes on Jesus, enduring hardship as discipline. But I'm going to pray for us and then we'll jump in. So pray with me. Father, Lord, we just come before you. We thank you for your scriptures, Lord. We thank you for your word. Thank you that you are kind. Thank you that you are good. Lord, thank you that you know what's best. And we thank you that we can just bring these questions to you with complete honesty, Lord, and trust that you know what is best for us and you know what is good. Lord, as we open the scriptures today, we pray that you would be at work by your Holy Spirit. Please speak to us. Lord, please transform us, convict us, and change us. And make us more into the image of Jesus. Pray this in his name. Amen. So I'm going to read verses 1 to 3, Hebrews 12, 1 to 3, and it says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." And so the author uses this image of running a race, enduring in a race. And he's saying the walk of faith is not a sprint, it's not over in 10 seconds. It's the long haul run, the run that requires perseverance. And the author says that in order to succeed in this run, you have to throw off everything that hinders you and the sin that entangles. Fix your eyes on Jesus. So how do you persevere in the faith? Throw off what's entangling you. It uses that image, like throwing off every weight. I don't know if you've ever tried to go for a run while carrying weights or if you've ever tried to go for a run when you have heaps of layers of clothes on. It's not easy. Not easy to run when you're carrying weight. It makes me think those Japanese game shows where you have to dress up in a big bubble or something and run around. You watch the people trying to run. They don't get very far. It's difficult. You can't run when you're carrying extra weight. The more you're wearing when you're running, the harder it is. You look at the Olympic runners when they're going around the track, what are they wearing? They're just wearing skins and sunnies, that's all. There's less on them, they run quicker. The author is saying that our sin is this weight. It hinders us, slows us down. And he says, throw it off. Don't let it hang around a little longer. Don't see how long you can run while you're carrying this. Throw it off. Running the race of faith without putting off sin is like running when you're wearing extra layers of clothes. You might still be moving in the right direction, but it's going to be a whole lot harder than it needs to be. Holding on to sin in your life is going to make it much more difficult. So let me ask you, what are you carrying onto at the moment that you don't need to be carrying? What sin is there in your life that's holding you back from running with endurance? I know in my experience of faith, there's been many times where I've been fighting against persistent sin in my life, where I've really felt that weight. It feels like a physical weight that you're carrying. You feel like you can't move forward in your faith because you're stuck in this sin. But I've also felt times in my faith where I have, by the grace of God, thrown off persistent sin. And it truly does feel like a weight has been lifted. It feels like you've been running, trying to move, walking through honey, and then you just get it thrown off and you can run and move freely again. There's truth to what this is saying here, that sin does hinder us, but it can be thrown off. It can feel like a physical weight that has gone. And the author is saying that living with this persistent sin is not the way to endure well in a life of faith. If you want to thrive in this walk of faith, do away with your sin. But the author is not telling us just to work harder. He's not just saying, try harder, throw this sin off. He's not just saying, just do it. He tells us how. He tells us how. And he says, fix your eyes on Jesus. Fix your eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. Jesus, who was already perfect, so you don't need to be. Jesus who willingly went to the cross, enduring the scorn and the shame and the humiliation of a humiliating death so that you didn't need to. And now he's completed it. He's sitting at the right hand of the Father. So what that means for you is that perfection is not required of you. Perfection's not required of you. What's required of you is to fix your eyes on the one who has already made faith perfect for you. So the question, how do you run with endurance and throw off sin, is look to Jesus. Consider Jesus and the perfection that he's won for us. When you think back to that metaphor of running the race, when you're running, your eyes set the direction of your movement. You run wherever your eyes are facing. If you are looking to Jesus, you will run towards him. If you're looking to your career, you will run towards your career. If you're looking to a relationship, you will run towards your relationship. If you're just looking to yourself, good luck trying to run well. Your eyes set the direction of your movement. You will run where your eyes are pointing. Fix your eyes on Jesus and you will run towards him. When I was in school, I used to do athletics. I used to do some sprinting before I became old and tear my hamstrings every time I run. But I'm in rehab at the moment. But I used to sprint. One thing I used to do was the 4x100 meter relay with a few other guys. So when you're running, you're passing the baton. One of the key things in these relays is the most important part is the transition of the baton when you're handing it on to the next runner. And what you need to do when you're running and what you'll do when you're training is that you mark out your steps. You know exactly when you need to start running. You look behind you to see when the guy behind you is going to be there. When he hits a certain point, you just start running and you put your hand out behind you. But your eyes are set forward. They're running focused on where you need to be. And it's so easy to spot the runners that haven't practiced their steps, because instead of looking forward, they're always looking behind them, waiting for the baton to be put, and then they'll turn around and run. And the amount of times I've seen, you know, a kid just run into the other lane and knock out another walker because they've not been looking in the right direction. When you're practiced, you know where you're going, but you're looking ahead. That's the idea. You'll run wherever your eyes are facing, and if your eyes are not fixed on Jesus, you will not be running towards him. So when you're struggling to endure, when you're facing that difficulty, you need to be going in the right direction. If you want to run well, if you want to run long, if you want to run with perseverance, fix your eyes on Jesus. But what does that look like? How do you actually fix your eyes on Jesus in practice? I think there's a couple of things that this means. I think one of those things is you need to make space in your life to see Jesus. You need to create margin in your life to see Jesus. You need to spend time in his presence. You need to spend time in silence and solitude, meditation on the scriptures, spend actual time considering Jesus, consider him and what he's done for you. This past term in our GC, we've been reading a book called The Possibility of Prayer, and just talking about what it means to create rhythms of prayer in your life and space for the Lord. One of the things that has been most helpful is actually the idea of creating space in your life in terms of your time, but also a physical space in your life, in your home, where you can spend time with Jesus. And we all went around as a GC and we all shared where the space is that we sit down and read the scriptures and pray and spend time in silence. Lots of us didn't have one. And so we encouraged each other to create a space. So for me, I have this armchair at home and I just moved it into a different part of the house, somewhere where I could be sitting in silence in the mornings and not be distracted by the crying baby. And just to make space to consider Jesus, a physical space where you're not distracted, where there's not other things going on, where you can just be dedicated to sitting in silence. Now, it may not be a physical space, but you need to create a rhythm in your life where you'll have the opportunity to slow down, be in silence, and experience Jesus and consider him. I think the second thing is to turn to Jesus in the midst of your sin. How do you fix your eyes on him? You turn to him in the midst of your sin. I think this means confessing your sin quickly. Confessing your sin quickly to Jesus. You do not need to clean yourself up first and then come to him. You can come to Jesus in the midst of your sin. I know in my experience, there's something about our hearts that just says, I've made a mistake. I'm caught in this sin. I just need to fix myself. I need a period of time where I'm no longer sinning before I can come to the Lord. That's not the gospel. The gospel is that you can come to Jesus in the midst of your mess and experience forgiveness because of Jesus' perfect walk. Turn to Jesus in the midst of your sin. The other thing I think that is difficult to do is actually to be honest in our prayers. I know for me, so often when I'm confessing sin or when I'm talking to the Lord, you're trying to put a good spin on it in your prayers. And I just think, who am I doing this for? Like, he already knows my heart. He already knows the mess that I'm in. He already knows what I'm struggling with. And for some reason, I'm trying to make it sound better than it is. And all that is doing is diminishing the work of grace in my life. You can come in the full mess of what you've experienced and experience the full forgiveness in the very midst of your sin. And you can be honest with the Lord. He knows your heart anyway. Be honest with yourself and be honest with him. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Remember his perfection. And your guilt and shame is done away with. One other thing I think that's important to mention when we're just having this talk about throwing off sin is I think often we underestimate the possibility for holiness in our life. I think so often we struggle with sin consistently that we just think, this is just never going to change. It's not for me. Sure, other people might see more growth and, you know, experience change and freedom from sin in their life, but for me, it's just not going to happen. But that's not the case. If you've accepted Jesus as your Savior, you've received the Holy Spirit, which means you have everything you need for holiness. Don't underestimate your capacity for holiness. In your walk of faith, you've got many years left. Your capacity for holiness is greater than you can imagine. How do you endure well in this faith? Firstly, fix your eyes on Jesus. But the second thing that the author of Hebrews says in this chapter, how we endure, is to endure hardship as discipline. So I'm going to read from chapter 12 again, from verse 5. It should be on the screen behind me as well. It says, "And have you completely forgotten this word of encouragement that addresses you as a father addresses his son? It says, 'My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline and do not lose heart when he rebukes you. Because the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastens everyone he accepts as a son. Endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as his children. For what children are not disciplined by their father? God disciplines us for our good in order that we may share in his holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it.'" And so what the author of Hebrews here is saying is that you are going to experience suffering and hardship in your faith. That's part of why it's so difficult to endure in this walk of faith. But he's saying that we experience these things because God is a good father who loves us and disciplines us for our good. So he's saying that when you do experience hardship, don't lose heart. That's the temptation that we face when we suffer, is to lose heart, is to give up, to get angry. Say, "God, why are you doing this? God, you must hate me if I'm experiencing this. God must be against me. He must be punishing me." But we're not left with that option. What this is not saying is that our suffering is punishment from God. Jesus has taken our punishment for us, was nailed to the cross. Our suffering is not punishment, but it does mean that it can be the Lord's discipline for us. And that might be a foreign concept to you. You might not think about God as someone who disciplines us. You might think that God is just someone who pours out blessings or should just pour out blessings and not give us difficult things as well. Maybe you were a naughty kid at school. I don't know. Maybe the idea of discipline is something that really grates against you because you experienced it as a child and you didn't like it. Maybe this idea of discipline doesn't fit with your idea of God. But the author of Hebrews is saying that God is our Father. He's a good father, and like a good father, he disciplines us. All good parents discipline their children. But no child likes to be disciplined, do they? It's not an easy thing to experience. You can probably all picture someone in your life who wasn't disciplined enough as a kid. They don't make great adults, do they? Everyone wants to, you know, every kid wants to eat ice cream for dinner, stay up till 11 every night, but, you know, it's fun at the time, but it's not good in the long run. The author says, just like our earthly parents discipline us because they love us, they want us to turn out well, God does the same for us. And I don't want us to miss this significant implication of what this is saying, is that we are God's children. He's made us his children and he cares for us as children. Because the reality is, this is what we talk about as the doctrine of adoption, is that once you were not God's child, but because of what Jesus has done for us, we've now become children. Once you were not a son or daughter of God, but now you have become a son or daughter. Those made new by the blood of Jesus have become his children. And there are many many privileges to being a son or daughter of God. There are many good things. You have relationship with the Father. You have relationship with brothers and sisters. You have been brought into this family that you weren't a part of before. Many good things. You'll experience, there's a place being prepared for you in the new creation by Jesus because he's made you his child. So many blessings, but perhaps one of the blessings that we don't speak about enough about being God's children is that he disciplines us. It's a good thing. The author of Hebrews says, don't forget this encouragement. It's not a negative thing. It's a good thing. It's a blessing. The Lord disciplines us for our good. It might not seem like a blessing at the time. It says it's discipline. It's not pleasant at the time. It's painful. But later it produces peace and righteousness. Verse 8. I love verse 8. It says, if you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline, then you're not legitimate, not true sons and daughters at all. So what this is saying is that discipline is the evidence of your adoption. When you're walking around, I don't know, you walk around the shops and you see someone else's kid, you know, misbehaving, right? You see someone else's kid hitting their sibling or throwing something on the ground or just behaving in a naughty way. What do you do? Nothing, hopefully. You don't do anything. It's not your kid. You don't see someone else's kid and, you know, you don't go and discipline someone else's kid because why? They're not yours. You don't care about them. You don't love this kid. It's someone else's problem. But if it's your own child, you do step in, right? If it's your own child, you do what's best for them. And that's because discipline is evidence of the legitimacy of this relationship. God disciplines those he loves for their good because he loves us, because he cares for us and he wants our good. And so the author of Hebrews says, don't lose heart when you experience discipline. It's evidence of God's love. When we experience suffering, how should we respond? Not with anger and rebellion, but with patience and trust and endurance. We have a little almost one-year-old called Millie. And so a couple of times over the past year, we've had to take her to the doctor to get her vaccinations. And when we've taken her, you know, it's a tragic experience because she gets there and she absolutely hates it. She doesn't understand what's happening. She gets there and she's looking up at you and you have to physically hold her down because she doesn't, you know, she doesn't know what's happening. She's trying to wriggle around. She's trying to escape. But you have to, you know, hold her down while this doctor puts the needle in her. And she's just screaming and upset when you do it. And she's looking up at you and the look on her face is just one of absolute betrayal and abandonment and just anger. And she's looking at me and it just feels like she's saying, why are you letting this happen to me? Why are you doing this? Why are you letting this lady stick this needle in me? And you're helping her do it. What is going on? Why are you doing this to me? And it's so hard to hold her down. But the reason we do it is because we know it's for her good. We know it's better for her to have these vaccinations. But she doesn't understand that. And so she looks at with this face of abandonment and betrayal. She can't possibly fathom why we would be doing this to her. But we know that it's for her good. So often that's the type of relationship we have with God. We're in the midst of suffering. We look at him saying, God, what are you doing? Why would you abandon me? You're supposed to be the one that cares for me and you're sitting here watching this happen. Why would you do this to me? But the thing between me and Millie is, you know, there's a 28-year gap between us. I know a lot more than she does. She's just a baby. She's very cute. She doesn't know very many things. And you think about the difference, you know, the difference in wisdom between me and her. It's pretty significant. I know a lot more things than she does. But imagine the difference in wisdom between me and God. So much greater. So much greater. And so when Millie's sitting there feeling abandoned because she can't understand why I would be doing this to her, and we're sitting there feeling abandoned because we don't know why God is doing this to us, remember that he does know better than us and he wants our good. And the thing about this is my relationship with Millie, I want the best for her, but I'm not a perfect father. I will do things wrong. I'll make poor decisions. My decisions for her are not going to be free from my own selfishness and selfish choices. But God is a perfect father. He is a good father. He's not selfish. He wants our good. So when we are in these experiences, we can trust so much more. Even than Millie can trust me, we can trust him that he wants what's best for us. He wants what's good. He knows better than you do. He knows better than I do. He's committed to our good. Those difficult times that I shared before in my experience, my walk of faith when we were in Adelaide, earlier in that year before everything became a mess, I genuinely, I believe, prayed a prayer to the Lord saying, God, I just I want to be made more like you, Jesus, and I just want you to do anything to make that happen. I truly think I prayed that honestly. I did want that. I hated how he answered it. But it was, that's what happened. It was painful for me to go through these experiences. And I had so many times where I was angry and just bitter and disappointed and furious at God, where my prayers were just me yelling and swearing and angry. But now in hindsight, I can look back, and this took years for me to process, but I can look back at those experiences and say, wow, I am thankful for that happened, because I am more like Jesus now than I was. He did answer that prayer, but I had to experience the depths of that discipline for this to become a reality. And it's messy. And Hebrews is true when it says it is painful, it's not pleasant, but it produces peace and righteousness. But only later. And you have to go through the valley to get there. So it says, don't lose heart when you're disciplined. Let it build resilience and strength. Let discipline build endurance in you. Everyone knows, it takes hard things to grow. If you don't, you don't increase the weights, you don't get stronger. Difficult things are required for growth. But how do you know if what you're experiencing is discipline? Because I think the temptation for us is, when we experience these things, is to think, if I'm suffering, God must be punishing me. If I'm suffering, it's because I'm sinning and this is my punishment. But this passage just doesn't allow for that to be true. God doesn't punish us for our sin. As I said before, Jesus has taken the punishment for your sin. First couple of verses of this passage state that Jesus is the perfecter of our faith. He's completed it for us. The punishment has been taken. So when you experience suffering, it's not God punishing for specific sins. When you're suffering, it's not God punishing you for specific sins. Jesus makes that clear in John chapter 9, when there's a blind man and the disciples ask him the question. They say, Lord, who sinned, this man or his parents, for him to be born blind? And Jesus said, it's neither of those. He's not being punished because of some specific sin, but the Lord is using this for his own glory. Sometimes our suffering, is a response, sorry, not a response. It's a consequence of our foolish behavior and our sinful behavior. It's not a punishment, but it can be a consequence. As many of you know, I've got a horrible ice cream habit. I used to have a really significant problem with binging ice cream. It sounds like a joke, but it's true. And when I would sit down and binge 2 liters of ice cream and then feel terrible the next day, am I being punished for my behavior, for my gluttony? No, I'm not being punished. Am I experiencing the consequences of my behavior? Yes, I'm experiencing the consequences of my behavior. Could God use that to discipline me? Yes, he can. More significant example, I guess, sad, you hear so many stories of this over the last few years, but one in particular, there's a lead pastor of a big Pentecostal church in America a couple of years ago who had an affair with a woman who wasn't his wife. He was obviously stepped down from his position as the lead pastor, had some significant and horrible trauma in his relationship, obviously with his wife, but also with his children, significant emotional damage and suffering with the church community and his friends and really everything. And he shared about this publicly on social media, and shared about even the physical, suffering that he went through as a result of the stress of his own sinful behavior. He continued to share over the next couple of years and experienced some really significant repentance and restoration in his marriage and restoration in his relationships with his kids and with his church. He was not reinstated to his position, but there was restoration that happened. And then later on, he shared that he had experienced how the Lord had brought good and peace and righteousness for him through this experience. Was his sin his own fault? Yes, it was. Was it horrible? Yes, it was. Did the Lord punish him for that sin? No, it wasn't punishment. Was the suffering that he experienced the consequence of his own actions? Yeah, it was. Did the Lord use it to discipline him? Yeah, it did. He can use our suffering for discipline, but it is not a punishment. And I don't want to oversimplify this as well. This is a really complex reality for us to grasp. God uses suffering to discipline us. And it can be very difficult to see God's purposes when you're in the midst of that suffering. But I just want to be clear about this. Just because you can't always see why you experience certain things doesn't mean there aren't reasons for them. Just like Millie can't understand why I would hold her down as this lady sticks a needle in her, sometimes we don't understand why God is allowing certain things to happen to us, but it doesn't mean that there isn't a reason for those things. And part of enduring in this faith is choosing to have the trust in God to just say, I don't understand, but I trust that your plan is better and that this will be for my good. The book of James talks about this as well. There's a couple of verses that will be on the screen from the first chapter. It says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Testing produces perseverance. Discipline produces endurance. And so there are many ways to encounter suffering and to respond to suffering in our lives. But I think what this is saying is that one of the wrong responses to suffering is to think, if I'm suffering, God must have abandoned me. It's just not true. This doesn't allow for that to be true. He disciplines those he loves. And remember that promise. He promises that later, peace and righteousness will follow. Is that something that you want? Do you want to be at peace? Do you want to experience righteousness? It comes through the discipline of the Lord, true, genuine promises that the Lord will bring. So when we are suffering and when you're feeling tempted to lose heart and give up, instead of asking the question, why am I being punished? Trust that God is in control. And I've got some better questions to ask when we're in those times. When you're experiencing that suffering, you're feeling that temptation, there are better questions to ask. Some of those questions are, what part of my character is God working on? What part of my character is God working on? What sin do I need to repent of? What idol am I holding on to? What fruit of the Spirit is God calling me to grow in? What foolish behavior am I reaping the consequences of? Better questions to ask when you're experiencing difficulty and suffering. How do you endure for the long haul of faith? Fixing your eyes on Jesus, trusting that he is a good father who does truly know what is best for you. Trusting that he does discipline you for your good because he loves you. Your discipline is evidence of the legitimacy of your adoption. Fix your eyes on Jesus. As I finish, I just want to share a story, another story from our GC. Steph Lee, who lots of you know, is in our GC. Steph has been for the last few years experiencing just consistent long-term pain in her back. She had an injury that causes significant suffering for her, issues with her disc. Hasn't seen any fruit for a long time. She's tried to see lots of different types of doctors and tried all sorts of different things to experience healing from this pain that she's going through. We've been journeying with her in GC through this. And she's been asking these questions. She's been asking God, what are you doing? Why am I suffering like this? Why is it not getting better? Why am I still in pain? One of the things that we do at our GC, or at least we used to do, we should start doing again, is we had a prayer journal that we would write down all of the things that we prayed for together. And then a couple of months later, we'd revisit it every now and then and just look through stories of God's faithfulness in answering prayer. It's such an encouragement. We've just seen countless prayers answered over the last few years. But one of the prayers that has not been answered is Steph's prayer. We've been, praying as a group for healing for her back, and it has not happened. She's not being punished for her sin. She's not experiencing the consequences of foolish behavior. She's suffering and she doesn't know why. She hasn't received any answers, but she has chosen to trust the Lord in his goodness. And she was sharing in our GC that as she's experienced this suffering and as she's figured out how to deal with it, she said, look, I've tried so many things. I don't have an answer, but the one thing I can control is fixing my eyes on Jesus and just working on my relationship with him, being in his presence and focusing on him. And that's what she has done. And it's still been difficult, but she shared recently that she's experienced just this feeling of peace in her life that she hasn't had for a long time, that she still, in the midst of her pain, has peace because she's controlled what she can control, and that's working on the relationship with Jesus. And the reality is, Steph may experience healing. We'll keep praying for that. But the reality is she may not experience healing as well. She may be in pain for the rest of her life until the Lord comes back and gives her a new body. But what she has been promised in this life is peace and righteousness because of the discipline of the Lord. It's been an encouragement to us. I pray that it'd be an encouragement to you guys as well. So as we finish, let me just encourage you to turn to the Lord, fix your eyes on Jesus, consider Him, make space in your life for Him. And when you are experiencing those seasons of difficulty, turn to the Lord in trust so you can endure well for the long haul. So I'm going to pray to that effect for us, and then we'll close up. And we're going to enter a time of worship as well. There are stations for the Lord's Supper at the back. Let me encourage you to go take some time, reflect, spend time with Jesus as you have the bread and the grape juice that symbolize His body and blood. But I'm going to pray for us. So why don't you pray with me? Father, we just thank You for Your kindness to us, Lord. We thank You so much for Your goodness. Lord, thank You that You are our good Father. Lord, that You don't punish us for our sin, but You discipline us for our good. Thank You that You have perfected the faith, that Jesus went to the cross willingly, endured the shame so that we could be made clean. Lord, thank You that that means that we are clean. And Lord, please help us to endure well for the long haul. Help us to fix our eyes on You by the power of the Holy Spirit, and help us to endure through suffering because we trust that You are doing what is best for us. And Lord, I just ask for the people in this room that You would bring about peace and righteousness in our lives, that we would be made more like Jesus, whatever it takes. We just pray all these things in His name. Amen.